Outcome measures in neurology is the overarching theme of this year's conference. In fact, we had already submitted this symposium 2 years ago before we knew that this would be the overarching theme. And it's particularly very dear to me because I think for clinical trial development, you need very good outcome measure. Any trial is as good as the outcome measure is. And we have seen a lot of failures with insensitive outcome measures. And I think the earlier you go in Alzheimer's disease, the more important it becomes to measure function, for instance, but also brain pathology at a very sort of high sensitive level. And we need to have measures that are sensitive also over time. So the first talk was about measuring instrumental activities of daily life, which is extremely important because people that we are now seeing are very early in the disease. They can manage their household, they can put out the garbage can, but they have difficulty managing their telephone or doing a bank transfer, for instance. So the higher complex sort of functions of daily living, and there is no scale able to measure that. So we developed one. And Sietske Sikkers gave a very good presentation of how the development, how the steps have been taken, how the validation in all the languages is now being carried out, and how we implement it in clinical trials. And we hope that this this scale will be able to give us some meaningful changes of sort of instrumental activities of daily life as a consequence of the therapy. So the two other talks were basically on imaging, MRI and PET imaging, showing a little bit how MRI atrophy changes over time can help you to find an effect of the drug, if there is one, even if the effect of the drug gives you the reverse effect, more atrophy instead of less. I talked about some caveats that were in PET imaging. It's very difficult to translate an effect that you see in a small group of patients in phase two that and translate it into phase three. That has been difficult, and I gave some options how that can be improved. And the last talk was very broad also about using CSF to measure changes over time in people treated or not treated. What I tried to do is to look at the studies that showed a positive effect in phase two, namely the bapineuzumab study and the gantenerumab study. They showed some promising results on lowering amyloid plaque load on SUVR PET images. And I tried to argue that using that technique is may lead to false positive results, because what you're measuring is maybe not a change in the amyloid plaque load itself, but changes in blood flow. And the technique SUVR is very sensitive to blood flow changes. So what you actually need is a direct measurement of the actual amyloid plaque load, and that can be done with quantitative PET imaging, but it takes more time. It's 90 minutes of dynamic scanning, and it's not easy to operationalize on a larger scale. But my argument was that that's not really necessary. You need to really have a good feeling of what is happening in the smallest scale phase two. If you're then really confident that actually the drug is lowering the amyloid plaque load by using this technique, then you can move on more confidently.